Thanks very much for joining us. My name is Chris Ellis. I'm a senior director at a small business in Toronto, Ontario, Canada called MASS LBP. And something that we're actually quite proud about is that, unlike a lot of the organizations here, that we are in the business of selling randomly selected citizens' reference panels. And this is our 10th year. We've been doing it for 10 years. We have been directly inspired by the BC and Ontario Citizens Assembly electoral reform. Some of our staff had actually worked on those as well. And they walked away from that saying, you know, these were very large million-dollar projects, you know, convening hundreds of people from across very large provinces. How about we make those a little bit smaller so public servants, not just elected officials, but public servants that are typically tasked with drafting policy can take advantage of this deliberative and representative kind of group of people. Fundamentally, we believe in people. We are a business, but we have a very specific social aim, which is to embed randomly selected citizens' panels directly into government as a tool that they can use to help build better policy, basically. In between some of my slides, I just wanted to show you some of the faces of the people that have stepped up and volunteered. They're not paid, they show up as an act of public service, and they are representative of whatever catchment area, city, province, or group that we are basically assembling, okay? So Civic Lotteries is what we call sortition. We have this kind of funny thing when someone is selected in a Civic Lottery, we call them up and we say, you have won the lottery. And people actually get incredibly happy and chuffed about being selected. And that's primarily why we call it a Civic Lottery. It's a little catchier than sortition, we found. We primarily call citizens' reference panels or residents' reference panels because we do assemble non-citizens or non-Canadian citizens or residents on our panels as well. It's the core of our business. We're not really a think tank, as I've said. You know, we have to basically prove this process to public servants because public servants are typically very risk averse. Given the opportunity to participate in the thorough and fair inclusive processes, citizens are always ready to provide constructive advice, particularly when it's matched with a fulsome kind of program or curriculum of public learning. I'm going to give you a really short case study or example. And this was our citizens reference panel on pharmacare in Canada. As it's probably well known, Canada has the privilege of basically having publicly funded healthcare. It's something that I think almost makes us more Canadian than any other things. We're proud of it. It takes care of us. It takes care of our families. But you know, over the years, people have noticed that there might be this one thing that may or may not be missing, which is funded drugs. And we were basically commissioned to run a national panel selecting 35 people from across the country that were representative of Canada or Canadians. They were selected through our Civic Lottery package. We have another one on the panel or the tables there. It's from another project, which is on mental health, also a national project. You'll notice they're also in bilingual. Most of our panels on this level, national and provincial, are bilingual as well. It makes facilitation a little bit more exciting. So we sent out 10,000 of these letters. We send them out roughly proportional to population. We actually work with Canada Post to do that random selection. That's the first level of random selection. We have no idea who these things are going to go to. After a couple weeks, we do a lottery process and we select people for self-identified gender, not just male or female, but if you are male to female, that sort of thing. We've also worked out a way to select non-binary folks. Age, based on demographics provided by StatsCan, which is our Census Bureau. General geography in this case, it was based on provinces, and you'll note there's a clump in the middle on the north. We clumped them together. Trying to figure out how to get people from way up there is actually really difficult, so we treated it as one area. Might not have been perfectly fair, but it was reasonable at the time. This was the breakdown of the actual panel itself. So as you can see, gender, age, we have to do language in Canada, making sure that there are Francophones on the panel. We actually asked a few other questions around coverage of pharmacare insurance. Out-of-pocket expenses, we wanted to figure out, you know, how much individuals would have paid for drugs on an annual basis. If there were high users, low users, that sort of thing, it actually would have altered their kind of opinions heavily. And we work with the client to put together a deliberative program. We do this all in-house. We facilitate it and host it. And we try to host them in beautiful places, actually, to kind of esteem the people that we've selected. We actually hosted this at the National Arts Gallery, which is where that beautiful photograph was with the totem poles behind it. After the actual panelists draft their own recommendations, and they do this in their own hand, we have a process for them to kind of co-edit this. We actually give them a certificate of public service. And we found out over years that people are incredibly proud of this document. One person was moving and they accidentally got water on it, and they asked us 6 years later to have it reprinted and sent back. And this leads into a report that is basically handed directly to the convener of the panel. We typically work only with government. We're commissioned only by government. In this case, it was a mix of a university and a government agency. These reports are typically presented by the panelists themselves to the decision makers. Two that were basically picked, male and female, would go and actually present the report, making sure that it was received and heard. We typically ask the clients to respond in some way to these recommendations. Even if they can't do it, they should just say, we can't do it because of this. In this case, we were actually invited to Ottawa to depute or to present to a formal commission, or not commission, sorry, committee on the parliamentary level that was investigating pharmacare in Canada. And instead of sending experts, we actually sent a citizen. Talked about the experience of the panel, presented the recommendations, and formally presented the report to Parliament. After this, things started getting heated up and people started becoming more interested in pharmacare in Canada. We're not going to purport to say that it was just a panel that did this, but it actually highlighted kind of the urging from the citizens to look into this further. So a few facts now that you kind of have an idea of the process. We sent out 350,000 Civic Lottery invitations across Canada. I cannot remember how many people that is or how much saturation that is off the top of my head. We've had about 10,000 volunteers say, yes, I want to devote, you know, 4, 5, 6, 12 Saturdays of my life not being paid or compensated as an act of public service to sit on one of these panels. We've selected 1,316 panelists via this route. We've had 39 deliberative reference panels, 170 sessions totaling about 1,400 hours of deliberation. We've been doing this a lot. As I said, for 10 years, I think this is a good body of work and we're quite proud of it still. Here's just a kind of an image and a little display of who we've worked for. We got our start in healthcare, working with hospitals, trying to figure out new services, transportation investment, which relates to new taxes, income fairness on the urban level, youth policy, cultural policy, municipal priority setting, and strategic policy, settlement services for newcomers, right down to actually directly influencing legislation with the Condominium Act of Ontario, which seems very boring, but when you match it with citizens that have been randomly selected that directly influence law, that's pretty exciting to us. So a few kind of hallmarks for us. Representation is really important to us, specifically for the Civic Lottery. And our concept of representation was actually influenced by, I'm just gonna flip forward and back, by the Supreme Court of Canada. They actually put together a ruling that had to do with how electoral districts are designed in Canada. And it's not just by population. It's not one vote equals one person. In Canada, they actually presumed they said, you know what, there are other factors that should weigh into this. It could be natural boundaries, like a river, but it should also be things like community interests, community history, culture and traditions. In Canada, we have a very large French population in Quebec and outside of Quebec. we have an indigenous population, and we need to balance those things out to make sure that there is effective representation in voting and democracy, and we've taken that wholeheartedly at MASS, and that's what basically has influenced our civic lotteries. Sorry. So I was asked before to think about, you know, we're actually given the opportunity by clients, by public servants, which is kind of a top-down method or approach. We are commissioned to do this work. And I've also heard of citizen groups that want to band together and fund this sort of work themselves from the bottom up. And both kind of have their trade-offs. And they all really revolve around the concept of legitimacy. For us, legitimacy starts with our civic lottery packages. If someone doesn't see, you know, in their mailbox this letter with a government logo on it signed by, you know, a deputy minister or someone high up in the government, they might not think this is serious. But why would I want to devote, you know, 5 Saturdays of my time where these recommendations might not actually go anywhere? They might not land at the feet of the decision maker. That's a consideration that we have to manage all the time. At the same time, I don't want to discount this bottom-up. I think you can create legitimacy around it by having things like, say, advisory panels or blue ribbon panels that would say, oversee the process. You would have observers that show up and make sure that it is, you know, reasonable and fair and transparent, which creates that legitimacy. And trying to find the way to actually connect it directly to policymakers is probably the hardest thing to actually manage. So, for our point of view, it's not actually radical or revolutionary. You know, it might be a little. We're asking a lot of public servants to actually trust this process. But for us, it's just really good government. And that's something that we basically live and breathe in MASS. And I think that's it. The one thing I want to leave you with is that this year, finally, I personally got my act together, and put together a how-to for civic lotteries. It's a very technical document about actually how you can proceed and how you should do it and all the considerations within. With that, I would like to welcome Adam to our grand stage.